That's a great beginning. Welcome, everyone, to the fourth episode of the Biology of Musicology. I'm your host, Dr. Todd Samra, and today we are talking about George Gershwin and An American in Paris. And you may be asking yourself, why is he wearing that shirt? Well, because I bought this shirt in Paris, and I was an American in Paris, and so this is my, I guess, appropriate attire to talk about this piece of music. Okay, so what do you know about Gershwin? What can you tell me about him? You can send me emails, you can write comments below. What do you know about George Gershwin? What a lot of people think about are the popular tunes. I've Got Rhythm, Fascinating Rhythm, Someone to Watch Over Me, Nice Work If You Can Get It, which leads me into what he did for a living. He worked in the Brill Building in New York City and wrote music as like a day job, as a desk job. And out of that, he produced a whole bunch of Broadway musicals and a lot of basically popular hits. Back in that time, there really wasn't much of a distinction between the two. As a matter of fact, Broadway musicals of the 1920s really were the vehicle sort of for these hit factories. And we compare it today, you know, like or things in like the 1980s when they were record companies were really trying to produce, you know, hits after hit. So that's really what his job was to produce hits. So these tunes, you know, are all wonderful choices to represent what we know of his music, because that was his job. That's how he made his money, and that's how he earned his reputation alongside his brother Ira, who primarily was responsible to be the lyricist in this. Of course, the other work that people think of when they think of George Gershwin is Rhapsody in Blue. That's the one that always comes to mind, and it's one of the most famous pieces of classical music in the United States, maybe even abroad. That piece gets performed internationally quite often. It's a highly respected work. It's not a piano concerto, but it features the piano, and it is an extended work. But it's a misunderstood work in a lot of ways. I mean, Leonard Bernstein, just to take it from him, said himself that this piece is not really a classical piece of music. And to back that up, he really went on to say that that Gershwin basically wrote what he knew how to write. We're going to talk about that a little bit later. And so we don't get something that falls into the norm of Western classical music. Bernstein described it as a disjunct set of paragraphs in a term paper that don't really relate to any particular single topic. So is it a classical piece? Well, I mean, technically it is. I mean, we define high art and folk art and popular art basically divided by, well, what did the creator say it was? If the creator says this is high art, like Andy Warhol, he said it was high art. It's a pack of Marlboro cigarettes. It's a can of soup. He says it's high art. So if the creator says it's high art. And that's kind of what we're looking at here with Gershwin and his symphonic poems. Rhapsody in Blue is, of course, a great example of a symphonic poem. And I do want to quickly mention that part of the origin for the possibility for Gershwin to happen really comes on the heels of Charles Ives. And that could be a whole other topic right there. And eventually we will do a show on Ives. But Ives kind of set the stage more for Gershwin than he really did for Bernstein. That could be an argument. But a symphonic poem, back to what that is. So there's a program symphony, there's a symphonic poem, and then there's a tone poem. And a program symphony is something more like Beethoven No. 6, Hector Berlioz's Symphonie Fantastique. A symphonic poem could be anything from Gershwin's works for orchestra to things like the Debussy Prelude to the Afternoon with the Faun, or even Liszt. We think of Faust, for example, by Liszt. That would be an example of a symphonic poem. A tone poem, even though many other people have used that genre title, really belongs to Richard Strauss. We really kind of like leave that up to him. And it was a distinction for him in creating a symphonic work where there was a single movement. Think Also sprach Zarathustra. think Don Quixote, you know, works that were more of a single movement. He was trying to create something different than the traditional symphonic poem, but it's still a programmatic work for orchestra. That's really kind of the definition. So in looking at American in Paris, let's look at it as a symphonic poem, but as the symphonic poem as it compares to like Debussy, Prelude to the Afternoon of Fawn. So speaking of Paris, George Gershwin, 1898 to 1937, arrived there in 1928. And it would be an event that would inspire him to compose An American in Paris later when he got back to New York City. It premiered in December at Carnegie Hall in that same year. And they actually brought taxi horns from cars in Paris to Carnegie Hall in the theater and used them in the original performance. Gershwin didn't really have a great experience when he went to Paris. I mean, we look at the experience that Aaron Copland had right around the same time. Aaron Copland's born in the year 1900, so they're very close contemporaries with one another. I mean, he had a great experience there. And of course, Leonard Bernstein and other composers like Leo Sowerby, Virgil Thompson, even Philip Glass are eventually going to go there and work with the great, great teacher, Nadia Boulanger. Well, Gershwin goes to work with Boulanger, and the lesson lasted only 10 minutes. And then it was really like an audition. And then he was basically done. She was done with him, and his chance with her was kind of over. I mean, even Philip Glass, when he talked about when he went over there to work with her, and he was referring to pitches like we do in the States and as we do in Germany by letter names, they don't do that in France. They use solfège syllable names. And so he had one day to convert how he talked about everything, or she was going to be done with him. So she was pretty strict. So she had dismissed Gershwin. But then Gershwin sought lessons with Ravel, and he actually met Ravel when Ravel came to New York City, which was previous to him going to Paris. So when he goes back to Paris, he gets back together with Ravel, and he's like, "Hey, Ravel, would you please take me on as a student?" But what Gershwin didn't really know was Ravel had no interest in pupils. He had no interest in taking on students, really, especially related to composition. I mean, Ravel kind of went into like a room, a box, composed his music, and just came out with like these 15 commandments. You know, that was kind of how Ravel worked. He didn't really want to share how he did what he did. I mean, time will tell. Ravel's going to be one of the greatest composers like who ever lived, but we don't really understand how he put his music together in the same way, like, let's say, Gabriel Fauré, who's a couple generations ahead of him, who worked at the Paris Conservatoire and had lots of students and taught how to compose and all of these wonderful things. So we know his process. We don't really know that with Ravel. So Ravel tells Gershwin, just be yourself. Be true to you. Don't try to be a pupil of me or anybody else. Just, you know enough. Just go compose. So it didn't really work out for Gershwin. And really, that's to our benefit that it really didn't work out that way. So instead of imitating French music in An American in Paris, which is what he did, he went there, he got an impression of the city, not to be confused with French Impressionism. Ha! He had an impression of the city, went back to New York, and then wrote a piece of music. But he didn't imitate or really use anything that was particularly French, except for like the car horns from the taxis. So, you know, it's really a very bold piece of music that is boldly American and isn't really very French at all. But that's okay, because Gershwin is being true to himself. He's writing a piece of music about this other place that he visited, got a feel for, and wrote this piece of music. I mean, very often painters have painted places they've never visited in real life. They've only imagined it or dreamed about it or saw it on TV or something. So, you know, it's totally fine that this piece isn't Parisian in style. He's not trying to be Parisian. He's George Gershwin. He's just being George Gershwin. The audience at Carnegie Hall loved it at the premiere, and they responded with a lot of enthusiasm, which was interesting because during this time, the late 1920s and part of the 1930s, there weren't a lot of, like, inspiring performances. You know, imagine going to Carnegie Hall and hearing Schoenberg. That's going to leave a certain impression on you. Going to hear Wozzeck by Berg. you know, and then the next week you go and you get to hear American in Paris. It's a completely different, refreshing kind of piece of music by comparison. But there were those who were very critical in the newspapers about this appearing, about this American piece, American in Paris piece premiering on the same program as the works of Franck and Wagner. And Gershwin responded, he basically just shrugged him off and said, it wasn't a Beethoven symphony, you know, it's a humorous piece. And that's very important because humor has revealed an enduring legacy on the concert stage, where great art is not always about great suffering. And I think that's a very important point. Gershwin meant this to be funny. He meant this to be entertaining. He wasn't, he's writing a classical piece of music, so it falls into that category of high art. But he's not trying to compete with Franck and Wagner and Debussy and Ravel. And really, at this point, Aaron Copland, who really wasn't writing the pieces he's most famous for yet. He's going to start to do that in the 1930s. So Gershwin's a little bit ahead of the curve on this. So we're just going to look at a couple of examples. I played one from the very beginning. But what I want to do is I want to play these car horns that I was just talking about, that he represents in the score musically with instruments. Here we go. So, very much those are car horns. Now, do they sound like Parisian car horns? Or do they sound like Manhattan car horns? I don't know, that's what he's pretty familiar with. This piece really sounds like New York City to me. It just completely sounds like New York City. One of the other things I want to point out is the rhythmic vibrance and variation that we have in this piece. And I think it's one of the things that when we look at Gershwin as a classical composer, even though we were saying maybe he's not a serious classical composer like these other, he's a great popular music composer, but he also writes classical music. When we look at his classical music, I think let's examine a couple of things. Let's listen first here for the use of brass and the use of rhythm. Two very, very important factors in music of the 20th century. Percussion. Triplets. I mean, there's a lot of punch there in that brass. Right? Right? A lot of triple tonguing and things like that going on in the brass playing. A lot of, this is not like, you know, just music you can just pick up and play real easily. It's very complicated music. So we've got a lot of that brass work, percussion work, the rhythm in there that I think makes it, you know, very clever. I next want to take us to 14 minutes and 27 seconds in my recording to go way in. Remember, you're going to be listening to these at home on your own. But I want to play this little section for you, and I want you to imagine the music of Igor Stravinsky. You know, post Rite of Spring, Igor Stravinsky. Stylistically, in terms of a primitivist, in terms of a post-romantic Stravinsky. Here. I mean, it's not in any way, shape, or form a direct ripoff from the Rite of Spring, but you can definitely see maybe the influence of Rite of Spring on this. I mean, this is just dotted rhythms. Long, short, long, short, long, short, long. But he's definitely orchestrated in such a way that reminds us of the Dance of the Virgins from the Rite of Spring by Stravinsky. So he's aware, Gershwin's very aware of these other classical composers. Now, just to go right on to this next little spot, just right after this, this grand, contemplative music that almost sounds like it could be from a Western. Doesn't it? Doesn't it sound like, hey, let's go over there. We're going to round us up some cows. Get on your horse. Grab your lasso. Head over there. Digs for some gold. Is that Clint Eastwood? I think maybe. Okay, you kind of get my point here. I think this music is so American. I mean, it's called An American in Paris. It is so American. It is everything about it is extremely American. There's really nothing distinctly French about it at all. But that's okay, because that's where his inspiration was from. And he knew he was writing a symphonic poem that wasn't meant to compete with Beethoven symphonies and with Berlioz symphony. Fantastic, and with Rachmaninoff symphonies and everything. He was writing music that was supposed to be fun, that was uniquely him, that was clever in his own way, that was true to who Gershwin was as a composer. And frankly, I'm so glad. I love it when composers really, really are true to themselves. I mean, Berg, we mentioned earlier, the Vasek, was not really true to himself. He was a composer in conflict of what, you know, Schoenberg and Webern were doing and what he thought he should be doing, and really wasn't true to himself. Where Gershwin was like, it doesn't matter what I should be doing. This is what I'm going to do. This is how I'm going to write it. And we end up with this great artistic classical music that really does ride the fringe between popular music, Broadway, popular culture, American culture, and just who George Gershwin is as a human being and a musician. Thank you for joining us today, ladies and gentlemen. We'll see you again next time on The Biology of Musicology.